Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Central Baptist Church. We hope you enjoy worshipping us with us tonight. This is our Maundy Thursday service, and we are doing it in partnership with Baptist churches from across Southampton. So whether you are logging in as a member of one of the Baptist churches here in Southampton or from somewhere around the world, we welcome you to worship with us here at Central Baptist Church. Today, as I've said, is Maundy Thursday. And normally the Baptist churches would gather together to share communion and inspiration on Maundy Thursday evening in preparation for what lies ahead of us over the Easter weekend. We were due to host it here at Central, hence the fact I'm taking the lead in producing the video, but I do have voices from across our Baptist family. We will be taking communion this evening. So if you want to, at this moment, to pause the video, to go get some bread, to go get some black currant or wine or even water, you are more than welcome to do so. In fact, I advise you to stop right now, press pause and go and get these things. Maundy Thursday is the evening where Christians get together to remember the fact that it's on this night that Jesus gave them commands. We often get together to wash hands and feet, to celebrate a meal together, just as Jesus did in the Passover celebration, and also to have bread and wine. We call it communion. The word Maundy is derived from the Latin word command, which refers to the commands Jesus gave to the disciples at the Last Supper about the wine and bread and how they should love and serve one another. Maundy Thursday is a time to deepen our commitment to Christ and each other, as we celebrate, commemorate, remember what is to come. To set the scene, because we are quite a child-friendly church, we've got a video for the children watching and to help us to concentrate on what lies ahead.
This time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses, when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. The disciples asked Jesus where he wanted to eat the Passover meal that night. Jesus said, "As you go into the city, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you.
Hello.
Follow him. At the house he enters, say to the owner,
hi.
The teacher asks, "Where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?" He will take you upstairs to a large room that is already set up. That is where you should prepare our meal. The disciples found everything to be just as Jesus had said. Later that evening, Jesus arrived with the 12 disciples. They sat down to eat, and Jesus said that he was happy to be with everyone. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. He said, "Take it, for this is my body, which is given for you." Jesus told them to do this to help remember him. Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. And he said to his disciples, "This is my blood. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many." Jesus said, "One of you eating with me here will betray me." He told them that things were supposed to happen this way, but that great sadness would await the one who betrays him. The disciples were very upset and asked, "Am I the one? Who is he talking about?" Judas asked Jesus, "Am I the one?" And Jesus said, "You have said it." One of the disciples asked Jesus, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus said it was the one who he would give the bread to. He gave the bread to Judas, and Jesus said, "Hurry and do what you're going to do." None of the others at the table knew what Jesus meant, so Judas left at once to betray Jesus. Then Jesus comforted and encouraged the disciples. He promised them that they would have a helper come when Jesus was gone. They all sang a song to God together. leaders and teachers did not like what Jesus was doing or how he claimed to be the Son of God. And so they made a plan to arrest him to get rid of him once and for all. Judas, one of Jesus' disciples, agreed to betray Jesus.
Come in.
And give him over to the religious leaders for some money. Jesus was in a garden praying, and Judas showed the man who Jesus was. Jesus was arrested and taken to the rulers of the land so that they could decide what to do with him.
After that video, we're going to pray together, and Rachel Watson from Fremantle Baptist Church is going to lead us in our opening prayers.
Good evening. My name is Rachel and I'm the minister at training at Fremantle Baptist Church. This evening I'm going to be leading prayers from the Northumbria Community Evening Celtic Prayer. Let's pray together. My soul waits for the Lord, more than those who watch for the morning. More than those who watch for the morning. Out of the depths I have cried to you. O Lord, hear my voice. With my whole heart I want to praise you. O Lord, hear my voice. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, who could stand? I will wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word do I hope. Lord, you have always given bread for the coming day, and though I am poor, today I believe. Lord, you have always given strength for the coming day, and though I am weak, today I believe. Lord, you have always given peace for the coming day, and though of anxious heart, today I believe. Lord, you have always kept me safe in trials, and now, tried as I am, today I believe. Lord, you have always marked the road for the coming day, and though it may be hidden, today I believe. Lord, you have always lightened this darkness of mine, and though the night is here, today I believe. Lord, you have always spoken when time was ripe, and though you be silent now, today I believe. And so this night, let us put our trust in the Lord who loves us. May he give us peace. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to come together and sing As We Come Together by Matthew Newman. Matthew Newman is a fellow Baptist living and working in the Northern Baptist Association, and he's written this song especially for this season of COVID-19.
In these days.
Hope you enjoyed that song. We found it very useful here at Central. We use it every Sunday to remind us of this season of COVID-19 and how God can even overcome that which we consider impossible. For with God, all things are possible. For our prayers of intercession, having sung about how this season is grounding us, we're going to ground it in a prayer. The prayer is that put forward by churches together in England, and it's a prayer for those affected by the coronavirus. Let's pray together. God, our rock and shield, we pray for our land and all nations and places of our world. As many are enduring the effects of the illness COVID-19 and the coronavirus pandemic. Lord, have mercy. For those who are ill, grant healing. For those who mourn the death of loved ones, bring comfort. For those who care for the sick, grant strength and endurance. For those who are isolated or whose livelihoods are threatened, give courage and hope. For all who take difficult decisions, from governments to health practitioners, give wisdom and compassion to accompany the knowledge and experience that they bring. O Lord, deliver us from this disease, we pray, and enable all nations and communities to grow in collaboration and unity as we face this challenge together. May there be a legacy of enduring common purpose in facing all that threatens our global common good. And may we, as your people, in the midst of our communities, share forth your love. We pray this in your name, O Lord, in the unity of the Spirit, across all denominations and streams. Amen. Thank you for joining me in that prayer. We are going to be led in worship again. We'll be doing this by preparing for communion. At the start of the evening, Jesus washes the disciples' feet. I can't do that with you, I'm afraid. But he then has the meal and celebrates and then turns to communion. And this evening, we are going to be prepared for communion with the song Remembrance by Matt Mayer.
Take this wine, now the sample made divine. for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we remember you. And remembrance leads us to worship. And as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. See his body, his blood, know that he has overcome every trial we will face. None too lost to be saved, none too broken or ashamed, all are welcome in this place. By your mercy we come to your table.
Helpful. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. So we come to the table. We come to receive the blessings of God, and tonight The words of the preparation are going to be given by Sean Sweeney from Shirley Baptist Church.
Good evening, everyone. And I'm glad to be able to share in this time of prayer and reflection on behalf of, and with the blessing too, of all of us at Shirley Baptist Church. So let us continue then to prepare our hearts as we come to the table and remember, as it's recorded for us in Luke's Gospel, when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And Jesus said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you the truth, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. Therefore, after taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And then Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So let's bow our heads in prayer and let's confess our sins before a holy and yet forgiving God as we come round this table and celebrate again his goodness to us in Jesus. Let's pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we gather in our own rooms this evening, just as your friends gathered with you in that upper room long, long ago. And we too, like them, come bearing the marks and burdens of a bitter and a broken world. And we confess our sins before you, so that we might not eat and drink in a manner that's unworthy of you this Maundy Thursday. Our God of mercy and love, we recognize that when Judas went out from that room on that particular night, a part of each of us went with him. So please forgive us for our betrayals. And so too, Lord, when the disciples sat unmoving at the table that night, each waiting for the other to wash their feet, we again recognize a part of each one of us sat there with them. So please forgive us for being so often unmoved by the need around us and for too often waiting on others to do for us what you have called us to do for them. And Lord Jesus, again, when Peter did not want you to wash his feet, a part of each one of us joined him in that rejection. So please forgive us for our selfishly ambitious hearts that want to tell you what to do, and give us instead the humility to become your loving servant and thereby a means of blessing to all. Yes, Lord, we confess that often our spirit has not been that of Christ, that we failed to love one another as he has loved us, and that where we've pledged loyalty to him with our lips, in so many ways, we've still betrayed, deserted, and denied him. So forgive us, Lord, we pray. And by your Spirit, make us faithful again, so that as we come now to give you thanks for this bread, and to give you thanks for this wine, that we're reminded once more in doing so, that in Christ the price is paid, and that for every sin, more than enough he gave and bought our freedom from each guilty stain. We give you thanks. We give you praise. In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Thank you, Sean. If you are able, can I encourage you to spend just a few moments in silence as you prepare to take the bread and to drink the wine. Lord Jesus, we recognize that this bread and this wine are symbols of your crucifixion. of a body broken and of blood spilt. So we take the bread and eat the bread, remembering that you did not hold yourself back, but gave yourself so completely. And Lord Jesus, we remember that you gave the wine, a communal cup that was shared by all. And normally as a church we would drink together, but tonight we drink apart. But we drink remembering that that blood has washed us clean. And we drink knowing that one day, one holy day, one precious day, one glorious day, we will drink it with you and you at the wedding feast of the Lamb. Lord Jesus, we thank you for what you're about to endure, for what you have endured, for the place reserved for us. Help us to be faithful, to be filled with your grace, and to be expressing your mercy. Not just at the table, but wherever we may be. Amen. Thank you for joining us in the communion. It's the first time I've ever led it in this way. And if you have any suggestions or ideas, please come back to me. I would like to hear. At Central, we always finish our communion service with a song of thanks. And so our next worship song is Thank You, Lord, by Don Moen.
One thing that I want to say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me, for all the blessings that I cannot see. I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In my life, you took my darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Grateful heart.
Disciples' feet, having feasted with them at Passover, celebrating that incredible act of the thwarting of death, having commissioned the communion, the bread and the wine, Jesus begins to sit down and teach his disciples. He takes on the mantle of a rabbi and warns them what is to come. And tonight we're going to be looking at John chapter 14. And our Bible reading comes from Linda Hayes, who is the minister at Fremantle Baptist Church.
The reading is taken from John 14, the first 31 verses, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Jesus, the way to the Father. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and also trust in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have already told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am. And you know the way to where I'm going. No, we don't know, Lord, Thomas said. We have no idea where you are going. So how can we know the way? Jesus told them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. If you had really known me, you would know who my Father is. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, Show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus replied, I've been with you all this time, Philip, and yet you still don't know who I am. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to show you to him? Don't you believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words I speak are not my own, but my Father who lives in me does his work through me. Just believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. Or at least believe, because of the work you have seen me do. I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I am going to be with the Father. You can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so the Son can bring glory to the Father. Yes, ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me, obey my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit, who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you, and now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you will live. When I am raised to life again, you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them, and I will love them and reveal myself to each of them. Judas, not Judas Iscariot, but the other disciple with that name, said to him, Lord, why are you going to reveal yourself only to us and not to the world at large? And Jesus replied, All who love me will do what I say. My Father will love them, and we will come back and make our home with each of them. Anyone who doesn't love me will not obey me. And remember, my words are not my own. What I'm telling you is from the Father who sent me. I'm telling you these things now while I am still with you. But when the Father sends the Advocate as my representative, that is, the Holy Spirit, he will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I have told you. So I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. Remember what I told you. I am going away, but I will come back again to you. If you really loved me, you would be happy that I am going to be with the Father, who is greater than I am. I have told you these things before they happen, so that when they do happen, you will believe. I don't have much more time to talk to you, because the ruler of this world approaches. He has no power over me, but I will do what the Father requires of me, so that the world will know that I love the Father. Come, let's be going. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Linda. To carry on the theme of this being our expression of our Baptist family life, I've asked Geoff Hunt, who is our regional minister at the Southern Counties Baptist Association, to share a few thoughts on this passage.
Well, thank you so much for this opportunity to share with you on this Maundy Thursday service. Unusual times that these are. And can I particularly bring the greetings of the regional team from Southern Counties Baptist Association, but also from the churches all around our association to you on this special occasion. David has asked me to bring just some reflections on John 14. And as Jesus meets with his disciples, John records for us some of the things that Jesus has to say to them. And of course, Jesus knows that in a very short space of time, the disciples will find themselves in a really uncertain, strange place. Jesus is about to be arrested, he'll be tried, he'll be condemned, and he'll be put on a cross. And for the disciples, well, some will abandon him, others will deny him, and they certainly will find themselves in very uncertain times, confused and fearful of the future. So what does Jesus say in preparation, encouragement to them in this moment? Well, John uses these words from Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Continue to trust in God. Do not be afraid. And he goes on to say this. You believe in God, believe also in me. It's easy to believe in Jesus when everything is going well, but when things are not going well, that's when our faith is really put to the test. When there are doubts, when there are questions, when faith is under pressure. And these are the times when Jesus says, continue to believe in me, continue to trust in me, even though everything seems to be going in the wrong direction. Put your faith and trust in Jesus. And I think that's a real important message for us in these moments, so that our hearts are not troubled. He goes on, actually set up by Thomas, who asks the question, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? And Jesus then offers, which I think are some of the most beautiful, fundamental words that come from Jesus' mouth. He says to the disciples, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I think in times of trouble, when we are fearful, these are such important words. See, in the moment where the way forward is unclear, by keeping our allegiance and faith in Jesus, we find the way into the future and into eternity. In the midst of confusion, uncertainty, and lack of understanding, by holding on to Jesus, we discover wisdom, understanding, and truth. And when all seems dark, hopeless, even when the path is leading to the place of death, by placing our trust in Jesus, there is light, there is hope, and life, new life, is revealed, and the disciples will discover that to be true. And the last thing that I want to just draw out from this passage that Jesus says in encouragement to his disciples is these words from verse 16. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The disciples will not be left alone, and nor will we. In these times of trouble and difficulty for them as they go forward, the Holy Spirit will be with them. As we move forward from this day into the future unknown of what is before us, we can be reassured of this great promise that is handed down to every disciple, that the Holy Spirit is present and always will be forever. And so in these times, this Maundy, this strange Maundy Thursday service, this strange moment that we have, hear the words of Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Keep believing in me as you have believed in God. For I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I have asked the Father to give you another advocate who will help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. May you know God's blessing and grace at this time. God bless you.
I hope that these thoughts were helpful to you as we prepare for Good Friday. Our closing prayers are led by Rachel Watson from Fremantle Baptist Church. We have no closing prayers and no final blessing here at Central during Maundy Thursday. The disciples sang a song as they went to the garden, but their garden experience was rudely interrupted by soldiers. So we leave our service, not with a blessing, not with a song, but with actually the words and the music of the deep, deep love of Jesus by Audrey Assad. If you would like to sing along, feel free. But could I encourage you instead to sit silently and listen to the words as you begin to ponder Jesus' experiences in the garden.